Our group was tasked to review the Practice Bulletin for Clinical Management of GDM issued by the American College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists in 2013. So this is what we'll discuss today. Three objectives. One is to understand that there are various definitions of GDM. Second, the epidemiology and who to screen. Third, the basic management of a patient with GDM. Here's the outline. The definition of GDM offered by the ACOG guidelines is the onset of first recognition of abnormal glucose tolerance during any part of pregnancy. This is different from those by the other organizations, which talks about diabetes diagnosed only during the second half of pregnancy. For these other organizations, diabetes diagnosed in early pregnancy is not considered GDM. The complications of GDM can broadly be classified into maternal and neonatal. So the maternal risks include gestational hypertension, preeclampsia, C-section and associated morbidities, as well as developing diabetes later in life. For the neonate, there could be macrosomia, operative delivery instead of a normal vaginal delivery, shoulder dystocia, and birth trauma. And in terms of the metabolic outcomes, could be hypoglycemia, hyperinsulinemia, and hyperbilirubinemia. The ACOG diagnostic criteria for GDM is fairly different from what we're used to in Singapore. What we're used to is more closely aligned to the ones used by NICE of the UK, which is in the rightmost column of this table. So basically, it is a 75 gram oral glucose tolerance test, and we're looking at either the fasting blood glucose being above, equal or above 5.6 millimoles, or the 2 hour being above or equal to 7.8 millimoles. Either one of them will qualify you as being GDM positive. And then the WHO has roughly similar guidelines, the one in the middle column, just that the values they use are slightly different, and there's also a 1 hour threshold. ACOG is using a two-step process, and what they mean is this. First of all, you will give a 50 gram dose of glucose, and then they measure the blood glucose at 1 hour. If it exceeds the value of 7.5 millimolar, then what they will do is they will continue to give 100 gram 3 hour diagnostic OGTT. If it is less than 7.5 millimolar, they do not proceed and the patient will not be diagnosed with GDM. You notice that there are four values there, the fasting value, the 1 hour value, the 2 hour value, and the 3 hour value. So in order to be diagnosed as GDM, you have to meet at least two of these criteria. Given the difference in diagnostic criteria by the different societies, then we expect the prevalence of GDM to depend on the definition. So if we use the ACOG definition, the prevalence is about 6-7%. It's high in certain ethnic groups, and the prevalence would generally mirror type 2 DM. The International Association of Diabetes and Pregnancy Study Group definition is a bit wider, and therefore the prevalence is actually higher globally. The different societies also have a different recommendation on who to screen for GDM. So in America, what they do is they recommend universal screening at 24 to 28 weeks. So this means that anybody, whether or not you have risk factors. Why is that so? Because they have found that in the past, if they only offer screening for those with those risk factors, such as family or personal history of diabetes, previous adverse pregnancy outcomes, and so on, they will actually miss out half of the women with GDM. In other words, it's not a sensitive test. How about excluding some people? Is there any way? So they've tried, and they found that there are certain features that will predict significantly lower risk. However, if they put in a special step just to exclude these people, they find that it adds unnecessary complexity to the screening procedure, and therefore they have recommended universal screening. The other thing is, if you know that someone has high risk, they would recommend earlier screening. And even if they're not diagnosed early, they're recommended to repeat the test again at 24 to 28 weeks of gestation. Now, NICE in the UK chooses a much more focused approach, and so they only recommend screening at the same time in gestation, but only with one or more of these risk factors. Of course, the highest risk factor is if you're a woman with a previous experience of GDM, so screening would not occur at 24 to 28 weeks, but will occur at bulking instead. Similar to the ACOG guidelines, again, if it's not diagnosed at that point, you repeat, as per usual, at 24 to 28 weeks. Finally, we'll talk about the management of GDM. After the initial diagnosis of GDM, the ACOG recommends that we monitor the glucose tightly. So we are measuring glucose at least 4 times daily, and then we record it into a glucose log. So this consists of a fasting, and then the postprandial 1 or 2 hours after the first bite of each meal. And this process can be done either every day or every other day. After good control is reached, then we can decrease the frequency of monitoring. First step is to go for non-pharmacological therapies. So in terms of nutrition therapy, you get a dietitian to look at the breakdown of calories into this rough proportion, and then also look at the number of meals. Apart from that, you can look at exercise, although the evidence pool is small for this. Pharmacologic therapies. So first of all, when do you initiate it? These are the thresholds. And of course, just like normal diabetes, you can use either insulin or anti-diabetic medications. RCTs have shown that there is no significant difference in glycemic control between these two modalities. In terms of obstetric issues, most of them can actually be managed expectantly. Most importantly, we are concerned about macrosomia. And so these are the antenatal fetal testing would do. And of course, if the fetal weight is significantly high, above 4.5 kilograms, then we'll consider a C-section. So postpartum concerns, GDM usually does resolve after delivery, but up to half of them develop type 2 diabetes later in life. So it's important to do some postpartum screening at 6 to 12 weeks after delivery using either of these tests. So reflections after reading the ACOG guideline. First of all, there are a couple of limitations. They're not specific about the early screening dates for those patients at high risk of GDM. And neither are they specific about defining what good control of diabetes is. And therefore, we don't have an objective cutoff for shifting from non-pharmacological to pharmacological management. Some areas of future research that we realized were the following. So the effectiveness of the screening techniques, both clinical and cost effectiveness, and then continuous ambulatory blood glucose monitoring. And actually, what is the optimal method for controlling glycemia? Although we said just now that insulin or oral antidiabetics are the same, there are some new generation continuous sub-Q insulin pumps, and we don't know if that's actually better. And finally, are there any ways to identify a fetus at risk of intrauterine death? Thank you for listening to us.